We'll make a start. Right. Welcome to the 39th meeting of 2015, the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. And remind everyone present to make sure that your mobiles are on silent. We have apologies from Dave Thompson, and we've been joined by Christian Allard as his substitute. We're awaiting the arrival of some others, including Angus MacDonald, who's indicated that he's caught in traffic. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private, and the first item today is to consider whether to take item five, consideration of the draft correspondence to the Minister on the Paris 2015 COP21 conference in private. Do members agree?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Thank you. Agenda item two, subordinate legislation, of which there are several items, the first of which is Snares Training Scotland Order 2015 SSI 2015/377. Are there any comments about that? There are no comments about it. Okay. The Plant Health Import Inspection Fees Scotland Amendment Regulations 2015 SSI 2015/392. Are there any comments about that? Okay. The Animal Byproducts Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulation 2015 SSI 2015/393. Comments?
Yes. I have a concern on page 20 of the regulation, and I think I would require some further information from the government before I was able to support the regulation. The difficulty I have is the disposal of fish mortalities in Argyll and the cost of it. The note at the bottom of page 20 in the table says, the information in the two tables indicates that where companies are landfilling fish farm waste at licensed landfill sites, and landfill is the only option in Argyll, they will be able to secure low-cost contracts with more sustainable processes once the landfill prohibition is in place. There's a bit of a cart and a horse in that, if I may mix metaphors. As far as I am aware, there are no alternatives presently available. If the prohibition goes into place and there are there's no anaerobic possibility, then local businesses will be greatly disadvantaged. I would like to see evidence that that paragraph is actually justifiable.
In that case, we have an opportunity to write to the Minister, because the reporting deadline is the 11th of January. In which case, I think we could possibly bring this back before that.
No, the only next meeting we've got scheduled is the 16th of December, and then the 13th of January. So
we're not having a meeting in the first week back?
No.
Well, we could have, especially if need be.
Well, I'd be very reluctant. Unless there is information available today, I'd be very reluctant to support this, because there's simply no evidence in the document that this statement is true. If it may be true, and in which case I'd be delighted to pass it.
Sarah.
Thank you very much. I suppose the issue I have is a step beyond Mike Russell's point, which is about the availability of anaerobic digestion options, because it certainly seems for some of the farms it's actually a relatively lower cost than other less or other more harmful methods of disposal. So it's really an issue for the Cabinet Secretary's team, which is what options are going to be available for anaerobic digestion, particularly in those more remote rural areas where economies of scale are always going to be difficult to establish. I totally get that.
Well, you know, actually, the issue from in an area which I represent about freshwater smolts, Kishorn in Wester Ross, future disposal option, anaerobic digestion, distance in miles 190. The one from Lewis is 200. The distance in from northwest Southern and Ullapool is 435. These are huge distances, but the smolts at Kishorn, we're talking about £470 a tonne, by far and away the greatest amount here. In the second list, the overview of future disposal routes. These are huge expenses for very small firms. Surely they need to get some answer about whether, in fact, what's being said, as Mike Russell says, is accurate. And indeed, to add to that, before we actually pass this, I think we should actually get these answers. Christian?
Yes, just checking as well if you're writing, if other alternatives are available anywhere else, if there are any ideas of other alternatives than the one listed here.
Okay. I think we've captured these points just now, so we're agreed that we will take this at some point, if need be, briefly, as a meeting, before the 11th of January.
If there are answers on this which are satisfactory, fine, but we need to know.
Well, we may be able to get some responses before the meeting next week.
Yes, okay, that'll be good.
So we're agreed that at this stage, with regard to the animal byproducts, that we're writing to the government about that. So the fourth item is the Trade in Animals and Related Products Scotland Amendment Regulation 2015, SSI 2015-401. Any comments about that? It's been pointed out that, no points at all. Okay, so we're agreed that in those three cases that we're happy to make no recommendations. Okay, we'll move on now to agenda item four, which is subledge again, and it's consideration of S4M. Sorry?
The third item.
Item three. Beg your pardon. It's the same item. Subledge. Designation of Nitrate Vulnerable Zone, Scotland Regulations 2015, SSI 2015-376. Alec Ferguson's lodged a motion to annul the instrument, and as is the usual practice in these circumstances, we'll have a brief evidence session, first with the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Food and Environment, to ask questions and seek clarifications. Cabinet Secretary. Alec Ferguson got some questions?
Not really very much, it won't come out when I move my motion to annul.
Okay, case, we'll ask the Cabinet Secretary if he's got opening remarks to make on this. Do you have? That's
what I started. Thank you very much. I'll wait the questions and we'll have the debate at that point. Just a brief introduction in that case, as the committee will be aware that this order is in connection with designating nitrogen vulnerable zones in nitrate vulnerable zones in Scotland under the Nitrates Directive as part of the action plan that we have to put in place in Scotland under our obligations under that European legislation. We recently changed the methodology in terms of identifying those areas to be designated, and that was broadly welcomed by the industry. The committee may be familiar with the long history of this issue in Scotland. And as a result of changing the methodology in Scotland, we've reduced the area covered from 14% to 10% of the country, and we have been able to take 2,200 farms either wholly or partially out of the designations, albeit, as we're discussing today, there are two areas that are designated as a result of the new methodology and in terms of the overall review we have to carry out every few years of the designations. There's one area in Angus and there's one area in the Stranraer Lowlands, which I'm sure Alec Ferguson's going to speak to. I think the motion to annul relates to the Stranraer designation as opposed to Angus. We've not really had that many concerns in the Angus area. What I would say, though, is that in Scotland, we've taken a very pragmatic approach to the NVZ designations over the years, particularly under recent changes in the last few years. And as the industry required, we carried out a review of the methodology, which, as I said, has brought some good news and was welcomed as a positive development by representatives, but allows us to fulfil our environmental obligations at the same time to tackle diffuse pollution, because this relates to, of course, the application of nitrates to farmland, which then runs off into watercourses and causes eutrophication, which in turn creates algae, which is a toxin, and that suffocates other plant life. Therefore, it's very much an interest in the environment to have these designations where they're appropriate. But we're very pragmatic in this country because many other countries have whole territory designations. Therefore, I would be loath to jeopardise the approach we've taken in Scotland, which, as I said, resulted in some steps forward in terms of the implications for actual farmers on the ground. And I would not want to be taken down a road where we have to go down to whole territory designation. I'm not saying that would necessarily happen. I'm just saying that's what other countries do. And, of course, the European Commission, understandably, watch very closely how we approach things in Scotland. So that's really the background I'd like to give to where we are today and why I've put forward these designations.
Convener, before I actually move my motion, I absolutely welcome the fact that the amount of ground in Scotland that's under this designation is being reduced. And I understand the reasons for doing so. What I have been unable to discover is actual figures that relate to milligrams of nitrates per litre of water before, for instance, the Upper Nithsdale NVZ was put in place, and after. Why is it, as far as I can see, impossible to get these figures?
Well, I'm happy to look into supplying. Clearly, there won't be time for today's discussion, but I can give you what figures I have, and so you can come back to me at that point. I'll ask colleagues to come in if there's any supplementary figures they can give. But clearly, the situation in the Stranraer Lowlands is that...
I was referring to the national areas that have been taken out of NVZ designations and why it is so difficult to get the figures for them before the NVZ was put in place. And now that they're coming out, it seems to me to be impossible to get comparative figures for before and after the designation took place.
And just want to clarify exactly what figures you're speaking about. Figures for
nitrates, the amount of nitrate in the water, which the main purpose of an NVZ in reducing diffuse pollution is to reduce that figure, as I understand it.
Yes.
To reduce the amount of nitrate in the water. And yet I cannot find figures for existing NVZs that show what those figures are before and after designation. In other words, that is how you monitor the success of an NVZ in the benefit to the environment, surely.
Yes, but the new methodology that was put in place clearly then allowed us to reassess the designations. We have a threshold that's under the Nitrates Directive, which is 50 milligrams per litre. And therefore, we identify those areas as best we can with the help of the Environment Agency and others for those areas that are above that. So, for instance, I'm sorry to come back to Stranraer Lowlands, just to use that as an example. There are farms there that are 102 milligrams per litre or 105 and so on. So, that's why there's a specific issue in that area. And clearly, in the rest of the country, you know, that threshold determined whether or not farms or land was catchment areas were designated.
Well, I hear what the Cabinet Secretary says, absolutely, but I don't understand why it's difficult to find before and after figures pre-designation for NVZs. It can't be found. If you could write to me about it, I'd be more than happy.
I'm happy to do that. I mean, I also have to send you the full analysis of the whole country's designations. I don't know if you know what's coming to.
So you wish to go back to 2003 to look at the figures then, Mr. Ferguson?
I'd like to know the figures for the
that's when
areas that have been taken out of it. I know I was on this committee.
That's when the Nithsdale was originally designated, was 2003.
Yes.
So you look to compare the 2003 figures and the 2013 figures.
That would be useful.
Yeah, that's what we can do. But just to kind of clarify as well, under the new methodology, the Water Framework Directive was introduced in that period, and the Commission is keen for all countries to integrate the Water Framework Directive, Nitrates Directive in their approach. And we've taken that approach, and that's how the new methodology, which runs to about 40 pages, and I'll gladly send you a copy which gives every borehole monitoring figure for the NVZ areas in Scotland. That has been our approach, and as the Cabinet Secretary says, we're now looking at individual groundwater bodies, because before we were looking more at the loadings in a catchment rather than individual groundwater bodies. So now we're much more precise as time moves on, and we have a much more clearer figure of the actual nitrate problem in that groundwater body. So that's who we're looking at now, rather than comparison to the loadings that maybe in science moves on, as always.
That's fine, but I would appreciate those figures.
Yes,
thank you. Thank you.
The argument in this appears to centre around whether or not in the Stranraer Lowlands area a voluntary scheme would work and could be supervised. The argument from Alan Bowie in his letter says that considerable expenditure has been undertaken both through SRDP and through individual farmers paying for this, that the department in Stranraer is willing to supervise this, and that the NFUS believe that there should be a voluntary scheme. Can you just explain why you regard that as unsuitable or unnecessary or unworkable? Why would that be rejected?
You're right to highlight the crux of the debate and the concerns of the NFU and others, which is we should allow this to be a voluntary approach. There have been various inspections and studies of the impact of the voluntary approach, and it's simply not working in the Stranraer Lowlands. For instance, if you look at the Galloway coastal catchment area, which is not just the Stranraer Lowlands, but just to give one example of SEPA's inspections, SEPA visited 303 units, of which 81.4%, 247, were not compliant already. This is not even the voluntary approach, this is compliant with the silage and slurry regulations or the diffuse pollution general by
locations.
It's a catchment area, yes, of 300 farms that were visited.
Right. I'm just being clear what's been visited.
Yep.
I'd just like to know what's been visited.
Yeah. Under the Water Framework Directive, we introduced a programme of measures which was based on the PEPFAR Code, preventing environmental pollution from agricultural activities. And I do remember you, Mr. Russell, speaking about that in a speech at the SRUC-SEC conference a few years ago. So what we did is we took an approach that we introduced these. They were based on that code of practice, which there was an industry voluntary code in basis, and we introduced the general binding rules, which are fairly simple rules, which don't spread manure within 10 metres, et cetera, et cetera. So as part of our programme measures, we did farm visits on what we call priority catchments. We've done, SEPA have gone out and done these visits, and speaking to farmers and putting them right, no regulation, just keeping them right. And of these general binding rules, as the Cabinet Secretary said, in this Galloway Coastal, there was 81% were not compliant with these general binding rules. On average across Scotland, it was about 60%.
A convincing argument. If a voluntary scheme has not produced the results that are necessary by legislation, you have to have legislation. I mean, that's obvious.
So
I just want to be absolutely clear that the voluntary scheme might have been considered had the outcomes been as high or higher than the regulations, but they are not. Is that essentially where we are?
Yeah. We very much welcome voluntary schemes, and I congratulate that there have been efforts at a voluntary scheme in recent years, particularly in the Stranraer Lowlands. The example I was given was of a wider survey in the wider area, where even in existing regulations, there's not great compliance. In terms of the Stranraer Lowlands, I just reiterate the comment I made earlier on, which is in terms of the voluntary approach that's specifically been happening there, the threshold of 50 milligrams per litre in the water courses is way exceeded, and 102 and 105 have been recorded. So clearly the voluntary approach is simply not working. And in terms of the methodology, we have to take a consistent approach across the country. And you know, those areas are identified for designation, just as the 2,200 farms elsewhere in the country were designated as not having, or we found that they did not have to be designated under the new methodology, and therefore they are being wholly or partially removed from designation. So it's 2,200 out, 130 in. The 130 in is where the voluntary approach has not worked.
To be clear, there is funding available for those who have not, who have to undertake additional work.
Yes, there's a couple of ways in which we help farmers. Firstly, there's clearly funding for slurry storage. There's £10 million in the new Scotland Rural Development Programme for that. People who qualify are those who've not applied previously, i.e. if they've already got slurry storage, they've had funding for that in the past, they can't apply to the new scheme, but that's self-evident. And secondly, there's a free advisory service which we fund the SRUC to provide to farmers affected.
Want to ask questions? So, Jim, Hume first, then Claudia, Sarah, Graham, Alec.
Thanks very much, Convener, and of course, good morning to the Minister, Cabinet Secretary, and his colleagues there. It's a bit confusing. Say 300 odd farms were visited, weren't compliant. We're only talking about 130 farms to be added to the NVZ. It says the paper says only 130 farms, but I would say that shows a bias there. That, I mean, 130 is still quite a significant number of businesses. The paper also says that there are only a small number of farmers in the NVZ who aren't compliant regarding slurry storage. So I think you're 81% non-compliant. You said that's from a broader area, and that's from farms that aren't being put in an NVZ. So there is a bit of confusion between what you're telling us and what's written in our paper. So I'd like some clarification on that. It also states in our paper that there will be a sort of cost-benefit analysis done in 2016 regarding NVZs following the Brian Pack review. I wondered why that wasn't done prior to this recommendation that we have in front of us. Has there been any business impact assessment or economic impact assessment done for the area for the new NVZ farms? I do also note that you say there shall be funding available subject to qualification. Obviously, SRDB funds are limited. You said there's £10 million. I'd just like to get that clarified, if that's absolutely for this area alone. And what happens, of course, if it costs £10.5 million and then the later farmer applying may not be able to get any funding. So just two or three points there that would be helpful to get some clarification on.
Sure. there's a number of questions there. Firstly, I'll just, in no particular order, the £10 million is within the Rural Development Programme for slurry storage, applies to the whole country. But clearly there'll be a scoring mechanism drawn up for that, and those in NVZ areas will get a higher score when they apply for it, so they're more likely to get the funding in those areas. So the 130 farms, for those that do not have slurry storage, are more likely to get a higher score when they're applying, and then more likely to get the funding to help them. In terms of the 130 figure, what I was trying to do was two things. Firstly, I was giving an example of why there's an issue here, and I was trying to give an example of the SEPA survey that had been carried out over compliance with existing regulations in the Galloway coastal catchment, and I gave you the results for that, which is 81.4% were not compliant with existing regulations, which are already there. And then I went on to say that within the Stranraer Lowlands, which is the subject of 130 farms and the new designation, I was trying to give examples of how there's evidence that we have a problem there, that the voluntary approach is not working, which is obviously why we're designating under the directive. But at the same time, there's a lot of farms in Scotland coming out, and we have to be consistent with how we apply this across the country. The issue over the action plan and the assessments or the business case or the business costs, it's probably worth just saying that we have two things we have to do here. We have to review the designations, and also we have to publish and revise the action plan every 4 years. They're out of sync with each other from Europe. Therefore, the designations are being revised just now, and hence you've got the order before you for 2016. And then in 2016, we have to revise the actual action plan, which is the overall plan, which will involve a whole range of things to do with NVZs. So that will happen next year.
If I may, convener, just to follow up on one part of that, at least before others come in. It states that there's an indication it's only a small number of farmers in the new NVZs who aren't yet compliant with regard to slurry storage. Do you have an indication? Well, it says you have an indication of what that small number is. Is it 10%? Is it
12 farms. Yes.
Oh, you have an indication.
Yes, we know exactly. Could I just make a point?
Out of the 130?
There's 68 in the Stranraer Lowlands, and there's 12 farms that do not have adequate slurry storage allowance.
Sorry, you said 12, then you said 68.
There's 68 farms in the Stranraer Lowlands in total that's in the NVZ.
It's 44, is it not?
It's 68. There's some will be partially in Mr. Craigson as well. They're not totally, maybe 44 total, but some in the fringes will have part in the part out of the NVZ. There's 12 of these right at the moment that we've got. On the point about the 302 units at Galloway Coastal, if I could just clarify something there. It was not just done in the Galloway Coastal. This exercise was done across the whole of Scotland. 4,000 farms were visited. SEPA walked 5,000 kilometres of watercourses and found 5,000 breaches of the general binding rules under the controlled activity regulations. Did not take any regulatory action, advised farmers about what they could do to put that right. But that's just the scale of things that where the voluntary approach has not worked through the PEPFAR code.
Okay, thanks.
Claudia Beamish, then Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, could I just clarify at this point in the process, is it questions only or is it comments to be taken into account?
Well, it's questions at this stage. We're asking the Cabinet Secretary to answer with his team about that. I mean,
thank you.
The debate takes place in the next item.
Right, okay. I just needed to be put right there.
As it says
thank
on
you.
The order paper.
Right. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and officials. I think it would be helpful if you could say a little bit more about the support for farmers and the opportunities, because two summers ago it was I visited the Eyemouth Basin and I was very impressed with what SEPA was doing to not only walk the watercourses, which Ian Speirs you've mentioned already, but to look at the opportunities for making improvements. And I wonder the degree, it was quite disappointing in previous questioning that the voluntary approach hasn't worked in some cases. And I'm wondering the degree to which this has worked in other places so we could look at good practice. And whether if it has to move to a statutory arrangement, which I understand the arguments for, whether there's ever any opportunity to go back to it being voluntary after that if things are working well.
In terms of what's being encouraged at the moment to help farmers improve practices, clearly we are encouraging all farmers in Scotland to adopt nutrient management plans. It's in their own interest to do that for good business reasons as well as environmental reasons. And clearly, if we ever got to a stage where all farmers in Scotland had a good nutrient management plan in place and it was working well, then it would not be over-applying nutrients, or in this case, nitrate-based, you know, fertiliser or whatever, and therefore they would save themselves money and the runoff would not happen to the same degree into local watercourses with the environmental consequences. So it's in the interest of farmers to have a nutrient management plan. Many farmers in Scotland do have that at the moment. And also, as part of that, to adopt good practice on farm of when they're spreading slurry and how they're spreading it and so on and so forth. If that were to happen in a greater degree than what happens just now, then clearly hopefully we'd get under that threshold that's in the Nitrates Directive. And then for the next round of reviewing designations in Scotland, more farms could be de-designated. But clearly, the industry welcomed the new methodology, which tried to take a much more pragmatic approach, but still science-based. But we can't just support something when it leads to de-designation. If you're applying a methodology, it could lead to new designations as well. And in this case, it so happens that many more farms are coming out of designation than are being subject to new designation. But you know, we have to be consistent if we're to do what's right for the environment, and also we give assurances to the European Commission so that they don't take a heavy-handed approach with us. For instance, ask us to have a whole territory designation. And that's why we're taking this approach. So nutrient management plans are something we're encouraging in the industry. Brian Pack, in his report into the future of agriculture in Scotland, recommended that, you know, it was an absolute must that all farmers should have a nutrient management plan. And as part of our greening debate in Scotland, we're talking about making that mandatory for farmers to have a very light touch nutrient management plan, so they're paying attention to how they can save themselves money and at the same time avoid damaging our environment through diffuse pollution.
Sarah Boyer.
Thank you very much, Convener. Some of my questions have been answered, but I'd like to follow up the question just asked by Claudia Beamish. Minister, you've identified the fact that nutrient management plans actually save money and are actually good for farming businesses. And given that we now have quite substantial experience across Scotland with implementing NVZ designations over the years, what are the lessons that you have learned about the obstacles to change? I'm very conscious, having talked to NFUS representatives about practical problems and how people see design of requirements as being counterproductive. That's one of the messages that comes back to us. So what are the obstacles to change on farm for a farmer in terms of making those changes? Because although you say it's of minimal cost and it brings benefits, all change requires doing things differently. And that requires investment, it requires time, and it requires effort to change. I think all of us know that. So can we give us a bit about the obstacles to change and what previous experience from NVZ designations has actually helped? You say that there's going to be a two-year transitional review and that there is going to be support for farmers through local workshops. I suppose the question is, what confidence have you got that that's going to help farmers make a change in a time that is, you know, as we all know, is incredibly uncertain financially for them?
Thank you. It's a big question. I would, of course, say that you are right in that there are financial challenges facing particularly the dairy sector and many of the areas that will be affected by NVZs, but that is why there's £10 million of support available in the Rural Development Programme to help with the costs of new slurry storage. In terms of the obstacles for changing behaviour, you know, that is a big question. I think it's a cultural mindset issue often in the industry, in that we've tried over the last few years, not always successfully, to get away with the impression that there's big regulators about to land at the farm gate and impose really tough regulations that are expensive, whereas farmers just want to go on the farm, understandably. I think that's improved in recent years with the Scottish Environment Protection Agency working more with local farmers to talk through the benefits and understand how, you know, it can save costs at the same time. We use less fertiliser, particularly given that costs have been rising in fertiliser over the last few years. So there has been a bit of a cultural change. I think there's still some way to go. We can see that from the statistics that too many farms are still perhaps not taking this seriously enough as an issue in terms of the diffuse pollution that's been caused to local watercourses. And 17 bathing areas in Scotland, of course, failed. And one of the reasons cited for that was agricultural diffuse pollution, so runoff into our bathing areas. Not just because of NVZs, I'm not saying that, I'm just saying that's one general cause that's cited. Therefore, land use and agricultural practice has a big role to play in cleaning up our water environment. And more farmers understand that and are working with SEPA and advisory services supplied by the SRUC and others to move forward. So the culture's changing, but you know the mindset and cultural issue has been a big obstacle, I think.
Graham Day?
Yeah, a layman's question, Cabinet Secretary, but would it be correct to say that those farmers who have invested in slurry stores already and are doing the right thing won't be disadvantaged by the designation? It would in fact be the dozen who've been thumbing their nose at this.
It's a good point, and I remember having been through this a few years ago, and there was a lot of difficult debate at the time of the first round of designations many years ago. And I remember that once actually designations had taken place and many farmers started the record keeping, started the fertiliser management, put in place their new slurry storage, it's actually seen as quite a positive thing to do, and therefore, you know, the backlash perhaps wasn't as evident as some people predicted. So I understand that many farmers prefer the voluntary approach and many farmers prefer not being told what to do by legislation. But those farmers who've already taken those steps because they're in areas that are designated, I think generally have found it to be something they can live with and perhaps even beneficial.
So let me follow up. In practical terms, what would be the difference for those farmers once the area is designated compared to now? What would they have to do that they're not doing at the moment?
Well, effectively, just what I just said in terms of record keeping, of having to manage their application of fertiliser. There'll be closed periods that apply in terms of when they can apply the fertiliser and nitrates. And of course, they require slurry storage as well. And there is, as I said, there are periods by which they can spread the slurry, and there's regulations around that.
Okay. Just to follow on that, thank you, Convener, but it is the case that there will be some farmers, and as far as I know in the Lowland, Stranraer, Lowland area, it's very few, who will be disadvantaged because they have already received SRDP funding. They may be required to increase their slurry storage as a result of the NVZ without access to NVZ funding as it stands. As you rightly said, extremely difficult economic times for the industry. I'm not sure how they're expected to do that. Currently, there's a great willingness to comply. The NVZ may actually produce an unwillingness or an inability to do so.
Ian wants to make a comment there, so I'll let him do that.
If they had increased their salary storage under the current voluntary approach, which has been, so it didn't cover sales, this has been since 2009, the farmers in our loans have had access, unlimited access to an SAC advisor and funding for doing slurry stores, etc. If they had increased the slurry store to their herd size at that time, because the size of the slurry store is related to your herd size, then they wouldn't have a problem.
If they increased their herd size,
they should have increased their slurry storage accordingly, because that's a business decision, I would say.
Come to that later, convener. Are there any further...
Clearly, we can keep these things under review, because it'll all depend on supply and demand. You know, there's £10 million available. Clearly, we have to determine the criteria of who qualifies for that £10 million. I think most people would think it's reasonable that those who've not already benefited from the previous SRDP should be first in the queue to get the new support. But I will, you know, give a guarantee that I will keep that under review. So should someone have previously applied and has expanded their herd and needs further support, and if demand for the funds allows, you know, that to be reviewed, I would review that.
Because I think Mr. Speirs is being a little unfair, because it can well be the case that part of the improvements that have been made are to put up housing to house cattle that were previously kept outdoors, that by doing so you find you have a little bit of extra capacity, you increase the size of your herd and find that what you had perfectly well put in place with considerable investment is still could be improved upon. And I think it would be a great shame if they were excluded from SRDP assistance at this time. So I'm very grateful for the Cabinet Secretary's words on that.
And how many people apply to?
Yes, I understand.
Could I ask what the cost of a slurry store investment actually is?
Well, I think that varies, because some people will build huge slurry stores that can cost several hundred thousand pounds, and clearly it depends on the size of your herd. Are there any examples we can think of?
There's great variance, because it can vary between either having an actual tower slurry store or whether you put in a lagoon. A lagoon is a much cheaper method of doing. We'd put a lagoon which was lined to avoid any infiltration in the soil would be the cheapest option. But as the Cabinet Secretary says, there is a million gallon slurry store in the Stranraer Lowlands at the moment, which is a rather large container.
Yes. Christian Allard?
Yes, thank you. Just a point of information. I read that the maps of the designated areas will be available online. When will it be available online? From when? It's map from the Scottish Government.
The maps website. Online.
That's covered by my Scottish colleagues at Sockton. It's in the process. We're looking to have them online by perhaps the middle of this month.
Middle of this month?
Yeah.
Thank you. Are there no further questions at the moment? In which case, we move to agenda item 4, and this item is to consider the motion S4M14793, asking the committee to annul the designation of Nitrate Vulnerable Zones Scotland Regulations 2015 draft. The motion will be moved with an opportunity for a formal debate on the SSI, which can procedurally last up to 90 minutes. In practice, most of the issues will have been covered in questions, I hope, in the evidence session, and so it's a case that the officials cannot now speak in this debate, and I invite Alec Ferguson to speak to and move the motion.
Well, thank you, convener, and if it does take 90 minutes, it won't be my fault, I promise you. But I do seek to annul the instrument, and I continue to seek to do so despite the Q&A session that we've just had, because I believe it to be both unnecessary and ill-conceived for reasons that I will clarify, although if members will bear with me for a few minutes, I need to give a little bit of background before I do so. And if there's a little repetition in that, then I apologise. I recognise that the intention is to create two new NVZs, but as the Cabinet Secretary pointed out earlier, my comments relate solely to the Stranraer Lowlands proposal, which is in my constituency, in which I know in some detail. And it is in reality an area around Stranraer containing, well, I understood it to be 44 farms, but I think it may be 44 farming businesses. that may well include a further number of farms, so I'm happy to accept that. But there are 44 farming businesses, as I understand it, within the proposed catchment area of the Pultanton Burn. Now, back in 2009, as has already been alluded to, a meeting was organised by SAC Consulting to raise concern amongst farmers in the Stranraer area about issues relating to diffuse pollution and how best practice in slurry spreading and storage could considerably reduce the requirement for artificial fertilisers. To cut a very long story short, several follow-up meetings were held, a number of borehole sites were identified, tested and monitored with SEPA's involvement, and in 2010 a baseline questionnaire was carried out to identify the scale of the problem and how it could best be addressed. And what that survey highlighted was a serious lack of slurry storage capacity. Less than 5% of the farmers involved actually had more than 6 months storage capacity. And the practical implications of that were that slurry was being spread in large quantities at totally unsuitable times, which benefited neither the farmer nor the environment. And so it was agreed amongst the farmers involved to do everything possible to address these problems, and the Pultanton Burn Catchment Initiative was formed with three aims: of reducing the nutrient load, of sharing best practice, and of raising awareness of the rules and regulations pertaining to the spreading of slurry. And in January 2011, soil samples were taken from all 66 farms within the initiative area. And what that showed up was a considerable lack of lime. And this is important because a balanced pH, in other words, having enough lime in the soil, a balanced pH will result in a greatly improved uptake of nitrogen. Therefore, a low pH results in much greater nitrogen being able to leach into the water course. And this problem has been addressed. But the main thrust of the initiative, as we've heard, has been to increase slurry storage capacity so that slurry could be spread at the most appropriate times. And the result of that has been, with the help of SRDP, prioritisation on diffuse pollution. 44 applications within the catchment having been approved and which are now operational. And I would contest some of the figures shown, because I believe the results have been absolutely nothing less than spectacular. The first sampling back in 2009, and I think the Cabinet Secretary did allude to this, showed that nitrate levels in the water within that area were 47 milligrams per litre against a maximum under European designation of 50, I think was the figure quoted. So it was very, very close to the limit. By 2014, that level has reduced to 26 milligrams per litre, and that level has been maintained this year as well. 43 new stores have been built, giving 32 million gallons of extra storage, with 66% of businesses now having over 6 months storage capacity, as compared to less than 5% in 2009. 43 of the 44 businesses now have waste management plans, with further improvements envisaged, and that was something the Cabinet Secretary I think referred to as being a benefit of an NVZ. 43 of 44 already have them. Over 30 miles of the Pultanton Burn have been fenced off, creating 30 hectares of new water margin, and extra housing has been created for almost 2,000 head of cattle, and the list of benefits goes on. The Cabinet Secretary understandably spoke of doing what's right for the environment, but I don't think that even in his wildest dreams he could ask for much more than what has been achieved already in the Pultanton Burn catchment. So what's their reward? And their reward appears to be the imposition of an NVZ, which actually threatens, I think, to undo some of the great work that's been undertaken already through the voluntary initiative. Because the proposed NVZ is only going to cover two-thirds of the businesses involved in the initiative, as two other burn catchments are excluded. And by the way, I do accept that there is one borehole out of the, I think it is eight, no, the 13 or 14 that are used in the area that shows different results to the extraordinary reduction in levels that has been achieved in the others. And that's something that does need to be investigated and clarified. I accept that entirely. But I don't believe it relates to the entire area. So the proposed NVZ will cover only two-thirds of the businesses involved in the initiative, as two other burn catchments included in the voluntary initiative are excluded from the NVZ. The NVZ will actually have four different closed periods within it because of the different soil types in the area. Farmers won't be allowed to put slurry on arable stubble in August onwards from August onwards, I beg your pardon, a perfectly sensible time to put slurry on that sort of ground. And yet they will be able to spread some of that slurry on grassland in January, which is really not a sensible time to be putting slurry on ground. There will be huge complexities of because of these four different closed times, even within individual farms, and that can only lead to monitoring difficulties, I would deign to suggest. And it simply doesn't make sense to have that level of complexity in such a small area. And those different closed periods will also mean that it could be entirely possible that farmers won't be able to empty their storage tanks before the onset of winter, putting, I would suggest, even greater pressure on storage capacity and therefore encouraging spreading of slurry at times which are not the most advantageous. January-February spreading simply increases soil compaction, particularly in a wet year, and soil compaction just increases diffuse pollution because the runoff is so much greater. And yet, all of that it's the exact opposite of what the NVZ is intended to achieve, and yet it would be perfectly legal under the rules. And I would contest that these complexities are entirely unnecessary and could be avoided by introducing a single catchment-wide closed period. I would suggest it should be extended into October for the whole NVZ. And yet the singular lack of early engagement between affected farmers and department officials when the NVZ was going to be proposed have not even allowed these options to be properly discussed. And that's why I say and use the term that the NVZ is being imposed. Convener, in summing up here, the Tanton Burn Catchment Initiative is a massive success story. It is so because it is voluntary, it's bought into by 100% of the businesses involved, and because peer pressure ensures that everyone does the right thing by the environment and by their businesses. And the figures back this up. The imposed NVZ, I would argue, reduce the number of businesses involved by a third, increase the amount of red tape and bureaucracy involved when we're supposed to be reducing it, and introduce a reluctance to adhere to the new rules and regulations, which will take the place of the enthusiastic involvement of the voluntary initiative that has been the hallmark of the last 5 or 6 years of the initiative's existence. I think the proposal is unnecessarily complicated, it's ill thought out, and it won't improve on the environmental benefits that are already being achieved at this time. I would therefore appeal to the Cabinet Secretary to at least agree to the NFUS's request that this SSSI be, if nothing else, postponed to allow alternative options to be explored. And I, in doing so, move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. Members wish to make any contribution to this at the moment? Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. I've listened carefully to what my colleague on the committee, Alec Ferguson, has said, and there does appear to be cause for concern, which I haven't been able to hear until this time. However, having looked quite closely with SEPA at the Eyemouth Basin, as I highlighted earlier, I did see that it was very difficult to encourage and persuade farmers that the work needed doing, and if it doesn't sound too patronising, at that point in time it was a shared education process for the farmers involved. And I do have a concern that if we don't proceed with the measures throughout, that it will weaken the protection that is given. And I think that I recognise very strongly the targeted nature of what is happening in Scotland, and which you've highlighted this morning, Cabinet Secretary, and I think that's very important, and we don't want to jeopardise that in any way. And I would like to highlight the issue around that if something is voluntary and aspects of it aren't working, it moves to having to be enforced in a statutory way, that should again have the opportunity to be reviewed, which I think you've clarified. I think the finance issue is very important as well for farmers, and I take note of your earlier comments about the review of being able farmers being able to use the SRDP, and I do think it's very important if through no fault of their own they've installed a certain type of lagoon or tower and then they find that they're going to have to do it differently. But I think for farmers we look always for simplicity where possible, but that must not prevent the risk of it must allow for the risk of diffuse pollution being prevented. So it is complex, but at the moment I don't wish to support Alex Ferguson, but I would like those points to be taken into account.
Thank you. Jim Hume.
Thanks very much, Convener. I shall be supporting the motion to annul today. Just briefly, I don't think that we've seen enough of an economic impact assessment done to actually realise how much of a negative impact this will have on a quite fragile area of southwest Scotland. I'm also not convinced that the SRDP money would go far enough to cover all the costs that may occur in that area. These SRDP grants are of course competitive, and the 10 million is for the whole of Scotland, so therefore I shall be supporting the motion to annul.
Sarah Boyer.
Thank you very much, Convener. Well, I certainly listened very carefully to Alec Ferguson's reasons for not wanting to support this statutory instrument, and I think it's actually quite hard for us because we have to weigh up and balance off the fact that the Scottish Government has obligations under the EU directives to actually make sure that we tackle the issue of diffuse pollution. And I'm 110% in support of that. And like the Cabinet Secretary, I've now followed this debate for over a decade. And like him, I've sat on the other side of the fence as well. So I think the job of our committee is actually to test this and to do it to the best of our ability. And I suppose what I want to reflect back is I would like to hear a detailed response to Alex's comments. He's clearly talked to the farmers in the area, and a lot have actually attempted to take the path of going down the voluntary route and do the best that they can. And there were a couple of things that struck me from his comments. One was about the whole issue of soil management, which if you're not a farmer or an environmental campaigner seems incredibly remote from the rest of us, but actually getting good soil management that works both for farming and for our environmental objectives has to be at the heart of this. And I think I'd be really interested in the Cabinet Secretary's response, both to the detailed comments Alec Ferguson made about the impact of the voluntary code, and to go back to your points and your initial comments, Cabinet Secretary, about the fact that 80-odd percent of the farms in the area you've identified weren't compliant, and to try and bridge the gap between Alex's comments and that core issue about we need to demonstrate that we are compliant with European regulations. And my second point is to go back to the point of the exemplars from the farmers who have changed their practices and who have implemented these measures, the benefits they've experienced. And it's just to tease out that issue about the design of the scheme, because it's something we regularly hear from farmers that they are trying to do the right by the environment, and the design of their obligations from the Scottish Government cuts across what they're trying to do. And I think for me that's at the heart of it, is to try and tease that out and the support that farmers will get in making those changes. And you talk, Cabinet Secretary, about a culture shift, but all of us know that even when you've got something beneficial, a culture shift is not just mindset, it's also, it does involve costs, it does involve doing things differently. And if you don't believe the culture shift is going to deliver the objective, or that you think there's an alternative way to do it, it's actually quite hard to achieve that. So I think in responding to Alex's motion to annul, I think that's the things I think we need to hear, what the benefits are, why you've adopted this approach, and to make sure that those farmers that have already made the change aren't going to be hit by this, that they will actually continue to get the benefit of having made not just a cultural change, but actually changes in farming. And that, I think, is the key thing to identify. And that is a debate, because I'm very much in favour of using nitrate vulnerable zones to deliver environmental improvements, but we need to take people with us. And I just want to echo back to the Cabinet Secretary that the feedback we always get from farmers is that they don't like the design of the rules. And I think this discussion we're having today almost epitomises this, that there's a clear benefit that will come from action here, but bringing the people who have to implement that action with us is the key test. So I think that's really what we need to hear from the Cabinet Secretary. There is a proportionate measure. It will work. It doesn't disbenefit farmers who've already started to do the good thing. And maybe how to bring those that haven't yet done the right improvements, how they'll be brought on board.
And Mike Russell.
For me, the crucial issue is the one I raised the question about, could this have been done by a voluntary scheme? The Cabinet Secretary and his officials have made it very clear that the voluntary scheme was not working and was not expected to work given the circumstances, and that there were resources and are resources available to help those who are affected. So I have no hesitation in voting for it. However, I do accept the point that Sarah Boyack has made forcibly, that the way in which European regulation is explained to those who are affected and implemented does require to improve constantly. I don't think this is a surprise to the Cabinet Secretary. He and I have discussed this on many, many occasions over many, many years, but it is difficult for people faced with what they see as additional expenditure, which may not produce results any better than the results they've already invested in. There requires to be a much better process to be undertaken. Some of the initiatives that were taken in terms of farm inspections in the early years of this administration might be borne in mind so that we can constantly simplify the way in which we work with farmers and work with others to implement necessary regulations. But I think it is quite clear that the effort that the Scottish Government have taken to remove from the effect of nitrate vulnerable zones a very large number of farming businesses, that those who remain within it for good reason, and therefore that the regulation is required.
Are there any other members who wish to comment at the moment? No. In which case, Cabinet Secretary, respond to the debate, please.
Thank you very much, and I've listened closely to all the contributions, and I'll do my best to respond to as many as I can. The Nitrates Directive is designed to protect the water environment from nitrate pollution from agricultural sources, and that's why we're discussing this today. It's a detailed directive, it's got detailed requirements, and of course we're all aware that the European Commission is vigorous in ensuring compliance. However, in Scotland, as I said previously, we have strived to take a very pragmatic approach to ensure that we do meet our EU obligations, but take on board the views of our farming sector at the same time. And through that approach, the area of Scotland designated as NVZ, a natural vulnerable zone, has been no greater than 14% over the years. Unlike, as I said again before in the opening question and answer session, unlike some European countries such as Northern Ireland and many others where the whole territory is designated. Not just 14%, but 100%. But however, the Commission does of course expect a scientific approach to evidence and requires all Member States to demonstrate a robust methodology on which our designations are based. Indeed, NFU Scotland have also previously called for a more scientific approach, and we did deliver that in our last review of how we go about the designations in Scotland. In the four-yearly review of the designated areas carried out in 2013, we did develop, through the Scottish Environment Protection Agency, that new methodology. It was developed and agreed with the review panel, which included NFU Scotland, the SRUC, as well as SEPA and Scottish Natural Heritage as well. This revised methodology has supported a reduction of the overall NVZ area to just now over 10% of Scotland, down from the 14%. And targeting the NVZ regulations at where there's an identified problem of nitrates affecting groundwater quality is the approach we favour. And by applying that new methodology, 2,200 farms were fully or partially removed from the designations in February of this year, with 130 farms scheduled for designation from the 1st of January 2016, provided you support the order today. And I should say, at the time of those announcements, they were warmly welcomed by a range of stakeholders and the wider industry. But now the new designation relates to these two areas where nitrate levels and several monitoring points have shown maximum levels near or in excess of the standard. I appreciate that Alec Ferguson and the NFU in Scotland and others have called for a continued voluntary approach to be allowed to stay in place in the Sunra Lowlands. Since 2009, we have financially supported such actions. However, they have not delivered the required improvements against the EU set standards. I listened carefully to Alec Ferguson's concerns and those of others. I would be willing to offer something which we've not really done before, which is that whilst we have a national action plan for NVZs, you are able to a degree, have a bespoke action plan for local areas. So I'd be willing to give a commitment today to go away and look at whether we can introduce a more bespoke action plan for the Sunra Lowlands. I'm sure there's something we can do there. It still means we have to abide by the directive, but in terms of the wider action plan and implementation, I would be willing to ask officials to look and see if there's a Stranraer Lowlands action plan that could be developed, because I understand some of the concerns expressed by members of the committee. But it is the fact, looking at the figures, and I appreciate there's a lot of figures in these long documents. If you look at the figures over the areas that have been tested and the area being discussed, of all the areas, and looking at the trends projected from the results taken of the nitrate levels, five of the areas tested, be they burns or boreholes, showed that five trends over the next 3 years, the last 3 years, showed no change in the trend, five showed an improvement, and five showed a deterioration. So of the areas tested for nitrate levels in the area being discussed, 50% of those where there's been a change have been a deterioration. So the voluntary approach I welcome, and I know there'll be many farmers that have done good things, but clearly we have to be consistent in how we apply the science and the methodology across the country. And in this area we have a situation, as I just said, where 50% of those areas, be they boreholes or burns, have shown a deterioration in trend over the last few years. So I think we're justified in designating that particular area. Turning to Sarah Boyack's comments, again, you know, we could discuss for hours, and I'm not going to take up the 90 minutes, the change in culture and mindset of Scottish agriculture, and I've learnt a number of lessons over the last few years in this post. But many farmers say to me that they look across the water to Ireland, which has an initiative called Origin Green, and they're using that in the international marketplace to market Irish produce, and the farming sector behind that, and are leading in that marketing message. I think the message they're trying to convey to the rest of the world is that Ireland is greener in terms of agriculture than many other places, and therefore people who are looking to buy produce that's been produced sustainably should look to the Irish label. And I'll leave others to determine as to whether or not that's justified. But the farmers in Scotland would tell me that they are looking at what's happening across the water. I say that's why we're doing our best to work together to green Scottish agriculture as well, to get the benefits from the marketplace of being greener. But we have to walk the walk as well as talk the talk. So in terms of the progress we are making with tackling agricultural diffuse pollution, we have to continue to make that progress, and we have to show that we are walking the walk and not just talking the talk. So in response to Sarah Boyack, I would say that I think this is all part of the greening of agricultural debate. What we do has got to be credible, it's got to be consistent, but it's got to be proportionate and pragmatic, and I think this designation is that at the same time. Finally, we did not put forward those designations as part of the overall designations because we understood the need for more transparency over the Stranraer Lowlands and the area in Angus, so that's why we have this order being discussed today, and we've had the opportunity to focus on some of the issues around that area of Scotland. But I think what we're doing is the right thing to do to help tackle diffuse pollution from agriculture in Scotland and to fulfil our obligations under the Nitrates Directive, and indeed capture all the other benefits that are available for farming businesses in the areas affected. And I hope we can work together in the months and years ahead to get to a better place. And once we're in that place, there'll be another review of the designations, and hopefully we can take different decisions in the times ahead.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Alec Ferguson, wind up and decide whether you're going to press or withdraw your motion.
Thank you, Convener, and can I thank all members and indeed the Cabinet Secretary for the part they've played in this debate. I hope it's clear that I'm not arguing against NVZs, and I'm not arguing against the revised methodology that has led to these changes. Absolutely not. I was very struck by the figures that Mr. Speirs gave for the, and I think yourself, Cabinet Secretary, in the testing that was done around the whole Galloway coastal area. And some of the figures that came out of that were quite stark, which to me makes it all the more extraordinary that the proposed NVZ is going to cover a group, a catchment, that is doing something about it when quite clearly there are an awful lot of others who apparently aren't. I contest Mike Russell's view that the voluntary scheme is not working. I like to think that the figures I gave and the figures that are on the table would show very strongly that it is. To have reduced the overall nitrate load in the water from 47 milligrams per litre to 26 and stable over the 8 sites that the initiative has been constantly monitoring, has been done by SEPA, it's not done privately, and that 26 has been stable over the last 2 years, has to show that something is being done right. And I did say that, and I accept fully, there is one borehole, one site that shows an opposite effect. But the fact is there are three so-called wastewater treatment plants in that area. Now, they're not wastewater treatment plants. They're actually sewage tanks, settlement tanks, on which in wet times, and I hate to say it, but Galloway has many wet times, these tanks are, Scottish Water have permission to allow them to overflow. I don't think any of that's been taken into account in putting up the scientific background for this NVZ. And yet I think that is bound to have an impact on some of the sites that are monitored. The Cabinet Secretary rightly said that any such designation has to be pragmatic and proportionate. But I'm a little sad that he didn't refer to the four different closed periods that will exist within this NVZ, because they are anything but pragmatic, and I don't think they're proportionate. He mentioned the what's happening in Northern Ireland, and there's a great deal of jealousy from the Piltantan Burn Catchment Initiative of what's happening in Northern Ireland, where I understand they have a single closed period and it's extended into October. Now, if that is the sort of thing that can be looked at when the Cabinet Secretary refers to looking at a more bespoke action plan, and I hugely welcome that commitment to do so, and I hope he will begin that process really in the very near future, then that is all well and good. But I'm afraid I'm not convinced that there is, overall, there is almost disbelief by the farmers who've taken part so willingly in the voluntary initiative that basically this is being imposed on an area, albeit a small one, that is actively engaged in doing everything it can to reduce diffuse pollution when there are clearly others who are not. And that level of disbelief and just non-recognition of what's been done leads me to wish to push my motion to a vote, convener.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Ferguson. The question is then that motion S4M14793 in the name of Alec Ferguson be approved. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. Therefore, will there be a division? And I would call for those who wish to vote for to indicate. For the motion. One, two. For those who are against, to indicate. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Hands down, and there'll be no abstentions then. The result is that there are two for and seven against. Therefore, the votes being cast, the committee disagrees with the motion proposed by Alec Ferguson just now, and we will indicate this to the government. Thank you very much for that item, and we will now make the point that at the next meeting on the 16th of December, the committee will consider various pieces of sub-ledge, a draft letter to the SRUC, and consider its work programme and approaches to its legacy report. As agreed earlier, the committee will now move into private session, and I now close the public part of the meeting and ask for the public gallery to be cleared. We will take a short break before we reconvene in private. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.